Recorded Books and RB Digital present The Introvert's Edge, How the Quiet and Shy Can Outsell Anyone, by Matthew Pollard with Derek Lewis, narrated by Jamie Jackson.
Foreword. I hate networking. It's icky and manipulative. This is ironic, as I'm ranked as one of the top networkers in the world by Forbes, Fast Company, and Bloomberg, among others. But I don't think of what I do as networking. I see myself as a connector. I love introducing two people who need to know each other. As soon as I meet someone, I begin thinking about how what they do could help someone I know. To me, I'm just connecting two people in an intentional way that serves their strategic purposes. I get a special thrill at meeting unwitting geniuses. For some reason, incredibly skilled people, technicians, creatives, inventors, thinkers, are the last to recognize their talent. I enjoy helping these people craft investment pitches, nurturing them through the process, seeing them access exactly what they need, and watching the success that comes from them discovering their own magic. I love helping people promote themselves. Again, it's ironic because I hate promoting myself. Despite growing up in a small town of 300 people in rural Idaho, I was incredibly shy. I was so introverted in my Napoleon Dynamite-like high school that I was bullied. Calling attention to myself was something I never did. I've been the CEO of successful public and private companies, but when I went into business for myself, I was at a disadvantage. I knew how to promote everything and everything except myself. Like networking, sales was an icky, manipulative thing practiced by used car salesmen and late-night infomercial hosts. I didn't sell myself, nor did I want to. I thought if I was smart, a good person, and really helpful to people, then I would get paid. How naive. I wanted that to be true, but it was a fairy tale. After the success of my book, How to Be a Power Connector, one of Inc.'s top 10 in 2014, I started getting call after call asking me to speak. I was new to paid speaking, so I vastly undervalued, underpriced, and overworked myself. When someone would ask my rate, I'd freeze, then mention what I thought was a big number. It wasn't, for just talking for 45 minutes. My clients appreciated what I did. They loved me and I loved them. But no matter how much I helped, my bank account never seemed to match the value I delivered. One day, I happened across an article on how to do a soft sales close. It was one of the best articles on how to approach sales authentically that I'd ever read. The byline? Matthew Pollard. From reading Matthew's other articles and then speaking with him directly, I felt I could trust him. He was a sales professional who wasn't trying to fast-talk me into, well, anything. He didn't want to use people. He didn't want to deceive people. He genuinely wanted to help. He did business the way I like to do business, centered around connecting people with what they really needed. Matthew challenged my basic beliefs about sales. For example, what I looked at as a 45-minute speech, I should have seen as days of preparation to create or customize a keynote speech, at least 2 days of travel, and the opportunity costs of working with other clients during the trip. That doesn't even take into account the value of the insights and experience shared in the presentation itself, or the one-on-one discussions with participants afterwards. No wonder nobody wanted to hire me. I was too cheap. As an introvert, and especially as a woman who is always taught to put others ahead of myself, I instinctively shied away from the question, "How much do you charge?" Here I was, a former executive of multiple companies, and I couldn't confidently answer a basic question about my own business. Matthew suggested one line that changed everything. Instead of waiting for someone to bring up price, I preempted it by asking, "Now, when you thought about reaching out to me or considered having me speak at your event, I'm sure you had an idea of what working with me would cost. What kind of budget did you have in mind?" I could feel the energy of the conversation change. Instead of me timidly presenting my fee, all of a sudden, they were trying to prove they had the budget to work with me. I began hearing such answers as, "I'm assuming I wouldn't get much change from X dollars. We really can't extend our budget past Y dollars. I know you probably charge more than this, but I was hoping you'd be willing to speak for Z dollars." The prices they quoted were 3 to 4 times what I'd been charging. Best of all, I didn't feel icky. I didn't feel deceptive. I didn't feel that I had somehow cheated these people out of their money. It was pretty validating, to be quite honest. Barbara Jordan said, "If you're going to play the game properly, you'd better know every rule." I was in the game, helping everyone win, except myself. Matthew showed me the rules I'd missed. I learned how to sell my skills while still feeling as genuine, authentic, and helpful as I had before reading that article. Except now, I also feel like I'm winning too. In short, Matthew's sales system pulled everything together and handed me my dream business. Trust his process and see what it can do for you. Judy Robinette, author of How to Be a Power Connector. Chapter 1. When introverts fail at sales. In the modern world of business, it is useless to be a creative, original thinker unless you can also sell what you create. David Ogilvy, Confessions of an Advertising Man. Alex Murphy's dream come true was fast becoming a nightmare. With financing from 2 family members, he had set up his own videography studio. Professional-grade cameras, cutting-edge software, boom mics, an impressive roster of talent, Golden Arm Media had everything going for it, except sales. As the owner and face of the business, that fell to Alex. Unfortunately, like many people who begin with subject matter expertise and then create a business out of it, he didn't have a knack for sales. In fact, as an introvert, he kind of hated it. After junior high, he had developed a pronounced stutter, resulting in a lack of confidence. Since he was already somewhat shy, this only increased his natural aversion to casual conversations with strangers. His discomfort with social situations persisted through high school and college as well. Fast forward a few years to Alex starting his videography business from scratch. It wasn't an established business with an existing customer base. He didn't come out of another business with a portfolio of client projects or an extensive network of people and businesses to tap. He had to build his client roster from the ground up. So if we're taking inventory, a natural introvert with a stutter, made worse during times of stress, with an aversion to creating small talk, a natural trait of introverts, a skewed self-perception and the lowered self-confidence resulting from it, who faces the challenge of forming new relationships that comes from all those factors, puts himself in a situation where his livelihood depends on being able to sell intangible services to complete strangers. Sounds like a recipe for disaster, doesn't it? It was. When he got on the phone or in front of potential clients, he didn't know what else to talk about but videography and business. If they tried to make small talk or if they happened to share something personal, Alex would just simply clam up. There was a long, unnatural pause while both sides figured out how to get out of the conversational sand trap they'd somehow stumbled into. We often say people do business with people they like. Having spent hours with Alex myself, I know he's a likable guy. But in a sales situation, he had a hard time getting over the hurdle of creating basic rapport with the potential client, much less establishing the necessary trust to persuade them to buy a customized professional service like videography. So sales sucked. The problem with introverts. We introverts live in a world, or at least in Western culture, that looks up to people who act like extroverts. We often describe the leaders we admire as outgoing, charming, and charismatic. Successful people look and act extroverted. Therefore, extroverts are the people we believe we should model. That doesn't work for introverts like you and me. It goes against who we are, how we're wired, and how we think. Sure, we can pretend to be extroverts and learn the tricks that mask our introversion, but at the end of the day, we can't escape our DNA. Asking a hardcore introvert to get excited about working the room is like hiring a performing artist to get excited about accounting. It's just not in their nature. Carl Jung defined introverts as being inwardly focused, while extroverts are outwardly focused. In another explanation, he described how these two types of people draw their energy: introverts from being alone, extroverts from people. In practice, that means an introvert can spend energy networking a crowd or performing for an audience, but we recharge our batteries primarily from being alone. Extroverts, on the other hand, can work in isolation, but they recharge from going out with a group of friends or being in a crowd of people. Take me, for example. I may look like an outgoing extrovert on stage and afterward while staying for questions or workshops, but once I get home, I turn my phone off and TV on, sit by myself for a few hours, no other lights or noise, and zone out to recharge my batteries. While I love helping people, the act of interaction depletes my energy. Contrast this to some of my extroverted colleagues who get a rush from being on stage and then look forward to spending a night out in the town. Speaking directly to Alex's situation, those who've studied introversion point out that we often hate chit-chat and small talk, preferring to talk about things that matter, or meaningful conversations, as many put it. Who cares about who won the game last night when you're there to get a job done? One telltale trait of introverts is what some experts call reflecting internally. It means that introverts do a lot more thinking before they speak. I have one coaching client who often takes so long to answer a question that we had to switch to Skype so I could tell the difference between him thinking and the call dropping. Extroverts, on the other hand, more commonly just think out loud. For us, though, our aversion to small talk comes across as being awkward, shy, uncaring, antisocial, or downright rude. We're not. That's just how it looks. Alex, however, didn't see himself as any one of those things. In his mind, he was just getting down to business. That's why he was there, after all. He didn't quite know what to do with clients talking about their child's recital or their plans for the weekend. Those things were ultimately inconsequential in a meeting about videography. It was almost as if Alex was trying to have one conversation while the person on the other side of the desk was having another. Getting through the sales meeting often became an awkward dance for both parties. Once Alex had gathered all the information he needed and left the potential clients, he'd go back to his office and spend hours creating a proposal, sometimes as long as 30 pages. As soon as he was done, he'd excitedly email it to them. Then he'd wait for days, weeks, or even months to hear back, only to find out they'd gone with someone else. He watched as his dream circled around the drain. The few clients he did land never quite covered the bills. His startup funds were rapidly dwindling. He had borrowed from his father and maxed out his wife's credit cards, both of whom also worked for him. If his business failed, it would not only wreck their finances, but also cause them to lose their livelihood. If something didn't change fast, he was looking at the same hard realities facing nearly every failing business: unpaid bills, layoffs, and ultimately, closing the doors for good. His wife Sarah later shared with me that because of the overwork and lack of results, she was shutting down emotionally. In her own words, it was just an awful, awful place to work. To say Alex was desperate would be an understatement. Of course, that desperation only fed back into the downward spiral. The harder things were, the more anxious he got about each potential project. If you've been on the other side of the table, you know what it's like to interact with a salesperson who reeks of desperation. When prospects smell it, They sometimes try to take advantage of it by negotiating for a lower price, or more deliverables, or both. Most of the time, though, it makes them uncertain, leaving them wondering if the salesperson will be able to deliver. Does the service provider lack confidence because they are desperate or because they're out of their comfort zone? If they're desperate, then they must not be very good, right? Nobody wants to do business with someone who's failing. Nobody likes dealing with a salesperson who's practically begging for the sale. If they're out of their comfort zone, it must mean that they don't have much experience, right? We want to place our bet on those who have proven themselves and who will still be there come tomorrow. Alex was referred to me by a mutual friend who just met him. I saw his work and was impressed by his talent, but not his salesmanship. I have a soft spot for small businesses like his. When I like working with corporate clients, I know that all I'm doing is helping a successful enterprise become even more successful. It's just not as soul-enriching as working with a small business owner, where I know that my work could potentially change a life. There's something heroic about people with enough skill, passion, talent, and belief in themselves to launch a business. It kills me to see those entrepreneurs fail at their dreams. I watch mom and pop stores open only to see the seats and aisles in these businesses go empty for a long time before they eventually shutter their stores. I've seen tradesmen with their equipment sitting idle in the garage, or home-based professionals with their calendars sitting empty before having to go back to their old employer. I think of how stressful it is on a family. Life savings lost, loans due, dreams crushed, divorce. In fact, I saw this happen to a friend's family when I was young. His parents saved every nickel to pursue their dream of opening a restaurant. I remember the excitement of the grand opening and how bright the future seemed. About a year in, I noticed his parents didn't get along as well. A few months later, they closed the restaurant and eventually got a divorce. His dad moved to another city, and I was able to see my friend only half as much. A small business has the potential to completely change your life, for better or for worse. Despite a great product or service, clients and customers who love them and people who pour their heart and soul into their venture, why do so many of these endeavors go under? They'll tell you their number one problem is the same as any other businesses. They can't get enough clients or they need more customers. After selling to solo entrepreneurs and enterprises, after consulting with founders and C-level execs, after founding a few multi-million dollar businesses, and after creating and running the now nationwide Small Business Festival, which I'm proud to say Inc. listed as a top 5 must-attend conference for small businesses, I'll share with you something you might already know or suspect in your heart of hearts. The introvert's roadmap to success doesn't look like that of an extrovert. We're different, and we should embrace that. What happens without sales? Red Motley said, "Nothing happens until someone sells something." I have to disagree, Red. Plenty happened to me precisely because someone didn't sell something. Because of a visual disability misdiagnosed as dyslexia, I graduated high school with the reading speed of a sixth grader. That, combined with braces and chronic acne, left me horribly shy and unsure of what I wanted to do with my life. Instead of going to uni, you Americans would say college, after graduation, my dad advised me to take a year off and get a job instead. After a year out in the real world, I'd have a better idea of what I wanted to do for a career, and therefore, what I should study. A couple of months before high school graduation, I found a weekend job about 15 minutes down the road in Melbourne working as a part-time assistant for John. Many names herein have been changed to avoid embarrassment. He'd formerly been an engineer for the manufacturer Caterpillar, but had been retrenched, aka laid off. Afterward, he became a real estate agent working with a large agency called Elders, first in the company's Kilmore office and then opening its new branch in Craigieburn. I wasn't the person out front speaking with customers. I was the guy in the back doing paperwork with a look on my face that said, "Please, please don't talk to me." I wanted to remain invisible. The thought of selling to customers scared me witless. With nowhere else to go, though, it was possible that this might be my livelihood for some time, so I studied everything John did. I'd always had something of an entrepreneurial streak, so it was neat to watch a new branch office being set up. I observed John go back and forth with the property manager to negotiate his rent, set up his utilities, and begin to work on the office itself. Contractors came to bid on remodeling the space, which included building partition walls. After looking at their quotes, John decided that he could save money by doing the work himself. He was an engineer after all. He spent months building the walls, painting, moving furniture, arranging the office, making sure the signage was perfect, and getting all the details just right. In fact, he often came into the office in overalls instead of a suit, so prospects usually mistook him for a construction contractor. When he introduced himself as the real estate agent, it wasn't long before they showed themselves to the door. After weeks of this, one day John walked in and said, "Okay, it's time for us to drum up some business." I wanted to say that that wasn't my job, but I reluctantly got in the car. While heading out to a neighborhood, I could feel my angst growing, thinking to myself the whole time, "Oh my God, he's going to make me talk to people." The extent of it was us driving to one neighborhood, parking the car, and dropping flyers into mailboxes, which I've since learned is a federal offense here in the United States. We didn't even knock on any doors, much less attempt to talk to anyone. I still remember 45 minutes in, John saying, "Okay, that's about enough for the day. Time for lunch." As a fresh-faced kid who knew next to nothing about business, I had no idea how sales happened. I was so relieved. All we had to do was play mailman. Apparently, an educated professional engineer didn't know much about sales either. In a short space of time, the Craigieburn office was shut down and John turned out. He went on to find another job, but what about his up-and-coming office assistant? What happened to the high school student who wasn't going to uni and had nothing else lined up? What happened to his plans of spending a year to find himself before going to college? I'll tell you what happened to him. He was left with zero ideas, zero contacts, zero skills, and zero options. That's what happens when your livelihood depends on someone else, and that person fails to sell. The result? People get hurt and dreams die. The myth of the salesman. Looking back, though, I can easily see now why John failed. He simply wasn't a salesman. He was a typical engineer, an introverted, analytical problem solver. Nothing he learned could have possibly prepared him for selling real estate services to homeowners. Going out to meet new people and drumming up business was simply not in his nature. It's not that he wasn't smart, obviously he was. He wasn't lazy. But rather than focus on sales, he focused on doing things he was already good at. He could say that he was trying to save money by doing the work himself, but the truth was, he hid from doing something that made him uncomfortable. Instead, he did what we all tend to do, gravitated to what he knew well. What's more, for introverts, the thought of selling their services isn't just unpleasant, it can be downright terrifying. Many of the introverts I work with can relate. They like doing what they're good at, and they hate doing what makes them uncomfortable, as do most people. So they concentrate on the work. Business owners often go into business for themselves because they're great at their functional skill. Lawyers start their own firms because they know the law. Electricians start their own electrical contracting companies because they're good electricians. IT professionals start their own consultancy business because they're proficient with a specific platform. But just because you're good at something, or even great at it, doesn't mean that customers will automatically show up at your door. Even if you put your money into advertising, usually not the best solution to your sales problem, you still have to speak to people when they walk in or call you up. Marketing may turn up an interested prospect, but there's still a gap between the customer knowing what you do and actually wanting to buy from you. You still have to sell. Of course, the problem is that lawyers, electricians, and consultants aren't salespeople. They're lawyers, electricians, and consultants. To them, sales is something done by salespeople. These smart people can learn how to balance the books, like a bookkeeper would, how to hire and train employees, like a human resources professional would, and how to address customer service complaints, like a customer service representative would. But for some reason, these same brilliant business owners don't think they can be taught how to sell, like a salesperson would. That's because they believe that learning the law or electrical maintenance is a skill, whereas sales is a personality type. To be successful at sales, you have to be charismatic, you have to be outgoing, you have to know how to schmooze and how to work a room, you have to be likable. Sales is something where you either have it or you don't. That's the myth so many introverts buy into. They give up on sales before they even begin. They think that because of their personality, they're not good at selling. So instead of learning how, they plow their time and effort into getting better at their functional skill and pour money into advertising, hoping those two things will somehow magically close the gap. Build it and they will come. May work in the movies, but if that's your strategy in business, you're just counting the days till you close your doors. Here's another myth. What's the number one problem small businesses cite time and time again? They'll tell you it's finding customers. However, after working directly with so many entrepreneurs and professionals in industries from writing to real estate to personal training, what I've discovered is that finding customers isn't really the problem. Business owners often have their head in the sand. They don't want to meet people, to network, to attend events, to get on the phone, or to set up meetings. They don't see the value in contacting past clients for referrals, and they have trouble qualifying leads and recognizing the ones with the most potential. It doesn't matter if you're the best voice coach on the Eastern Seaboard. If no one knows it, how can you expect to sell to them? These small business owners and entrepreneurs climb most of the mountain only to let their dreams die a few feet from the peak. The problem is sales, but it's so easy to fix. Working directly with thousands of business owners, salespeople, entrepreneurs, and professionals has taught me three truths. 1. Sales is a skill anyone can learn. 2. Anyone can create a sales process. 3. Armed with these two facts, introverts make the best salespeople. People go to school for years to become doctors and lawyers, coming out of grad school hundreds of thousands of dollars in debt. I used to tell my sales staff if they could devote just 2 weeks to learning my basic sales system, they could make six-figure incomes without the time and without the debt. Frequently, I saw the "this sounds too good to be true" looks, or heard, "how can you be so sure this will work for me?" Here's how I removed their doubt. Knocking on 93 doors. When John was forced to close the doors of his real estate business, I didn't try to figure out why the business had failed. I was too worried about what I was going to do. Here I was, just graduating high school, and I had no life plan. How was I going to make money, never mind start a career? They say necessity is the mother of invention. It was with me. John's failure as a real estate agent left me with no job and no prospects just weeks before Christmas. While the rest of my friends were celebrating their holidays, I was desperately hunting for something, anything, to provide some sort of income. In Australia, Christmas falls during the middle of summer, so it's summer vacation and the Christmas holidays all roll into one. From the middle of December to about the middle of January, anybody of importance is on vacation. Therefore, getting any kind of decent job during this time is next to impossible. My choices were quite slim. I'd already put off going to college, and there was no way I could tell my father, who was working 80 hours a week himself, that I didn't have a job. I searched through the newspapers. These were the days before they posted everything online. The one and only job I could find was a door-to-door salesman. The prospect of working one of these positions would make most people feel dread. For me, it was downright terror. I didn't like talking to people any more than John did. Years of feeling like the slow kid at school had eroded my self-confidence to nearly nothing. I was made fun of for the colored glasses I wore to correct my Erlen syndrome. As mentioned earlier, it's a visual processing disorder often misdiagnosed as dyslexia. And for my awful acne. I remember one day while playing basketball, the ball hit me in the head, popping one of my pimples. The ridicule hurt more than the hit. For a shy kid with a learning disability, disfiguring acne, and braces, having my only job option be walking up to complete strangers and trying to sell them phone plans, that was the stuff of nightmares. I didn't have the oversized personality of those natural salespeople we all imagine. I couldn't turn on the cheer and charm the moment I walked through a prospect's door. Back then, it was hard enough to rally my confidence to take the initiative in a group of friends, much less with a stranger. On top of that, I didn't have the mindset for sales. Despite my entrepreneurial streak, I didn't come from a family of outgoing entrepreneurs. All the parents in my working-class neighborhood went to work, punched a clock, and came home. Going out to find new customers was almost a foreign concept to me. In short, I was the absolute last person you'd expect to make a career out of sales. But I had no choice. I had to do it, and that meant figuring out how to sell, even if I had none of the ingredients to be successful in sales. This particular sales company was one of those commission-only places. My manager used to say that they threw mud against the wall and waited to see who would stick. Not much fun if you're the mud. Because I showed up in a suit and tie, I was immediately put into the small business sales group. Sales training consisted of 3 days where we went over the different telecom products and packages Auscom sold. After that, my supervisor told me to go out and sell. That was it. No coordination, no hints, no help, just go sell. I fully expected that every store I went to would tell me to get out or go to hell. That being the case, I thought it'd be easier if I went to where there were a lot of shops. That way, I wouldn't have to constantly get in and out of my car. When I was kicked out of one store, I wouldn't have far to walk to go into another. That's why I picked Sydney Road, a kind of nearby main street. I parked at the end of a row of shops, stepped out of my car, and looked at the dozens upon dozens of businesses. There I was, in the only business attire I owned, which had landed me a business sales position. A black polyester suit so cheap it shone in the sun, an awful lime green shirt and a bright red tie. I stood on the curb, looking at the long row of shops, all of which already had phone plans. I swallowed, walked up to the first one, and had my hand on the door handle when the realization suddenly dawned on me. I had no idea what I was supposed to say. They'd taught me about what I was selling, but they neglected to teach me how to sell. 92. That's how many times I was told no, get out, not interested, or my personal favorite, go get a real job. 92 times I was outright rejected. 92 times I had to swallow my anxiety and try to put on a smile. 92 times I walked out thinking, what the hell am I doing with my life? Finally, near the end of the day, I walked through door number 93 and sold a telecom plan. I was ecstatic. I'd finally made a sale. I walked out of that door with my head held high, already mentally spending my $70 commission, until I had a horrible realization. I looked down the street at the dozens of other businesses I still had to visit, and thought about having to do it all again the next day. And the day after that. And then the day after that. There's got to be a better way. I find that many people, when faced with a problem like this, will do one of two things. They'll either quit or redouble their efforts. Like I said, quitting wasn't enough.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.